Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. As part of the annual day, we today have a special panel discussion titled Advantage Tamil Nadu, Lives, Livelihood and Growth in the New Normal. The moderation will focus on industry next. I think this COVID outbreak has really given us in spite of new opportunities, I think it's also given us a new lens which we need to use to relook things and not do the same things that we have always been doing. So there is, I think, more amount of smart work required compared to hard work. And with this Industry 4.0, which has been there for some time now, fourth revolution of the industrial cycle, I think technology and digitalization is going to play a very important role. And we have already seen digitalization in the areas of education and healthcare. And I should say, compared to other countries, India was quite quick to adopt ICT and new digital technical areas in the teaching learning process. But I think schools and colleges today are operating online. And we have, I think, lakhs of students who are using online platforms to have their day-to-day education. And healthcare as well, I think, we have had a lot of opportunities which have come up in that sector. So I think we have opportunities across areas of, manufacturing, and especially in a very niche area, which India needs to do, I think, a lot more in terms of appropriate technology. Because I think we have a lot of, labor here who are unemployed for the simple fact that, they may be lazy or they are not exactly skilled or upskilled. And sometimes when we do a return on investment on technology versus on automation versus having human beings working on the shop floor, at times in certain areas it is cheaper to have human beings do the job, because technology is not always easy or always easily adaptable to all sectors. But I think when we do a return on this investment, we need to make sure that we focus more on appropriate technology areas rather than advanced technologies blindly. So appropriate technology is one area where our Indian education institutions can also do a lot more research in terms of patents, trademarks. There are a lot of opportunities in these areas. And CAA has also been working continuously this year. We have the Tamil Nadu Technology Development and Promotion Center, which exactly is doing these niche services for industries. So in this context, we thought we should have a discussion and call entrepreneurs and founders of many successful companies in our state, sons of the soil, most of them, who will be sharing some of their success stories and also giving us fresh perspective on how Tamil Nadu is advantageous for industries, and a special focus on industries next or the industry's way forward. We have with us Mr. Satyakam Arya, Managing Director and CEO of Daimler India Commercial Vehicles Private Limited, who will be the key moderator today, and he will moderate this panel. We also have Mr. Samik Roy from Microsoft India, who will be joining us virtually. We have the Senior Vice President, Mr. Raghuraman Ayyaswamy from TCS, Mr. Kumar Vembu from Go Frugal Technologies, company of Zoho, Mr. Satish, Managing Director of Milky Mist, and Mr. N.K. Ranganathan from Grundfos Pumps, also a past chairman. They will all be speaking on various areas in this panel. So I welcome Mr. Satyakam Arya and all the panel speakers today. We have about 200 odd members who are viewing this platform on the CAA Hive platform for viewing this panel discussion. So welcome to all of them as well. We will like to have as many questions as possible towards the end of the session. I would like to leave you behind with a small incident which happened in true life. I will be showing you a picture on the screen of a bridge located in Honduras in Central America. Can I have the picture, please? I think as the picture is coming up, I will just start telling you the context. In the year 1996, over the river of Choluteca in Central America, a 484-meter-long bridge was built, as shown on the picture. This bridge stands as a testimony for the one-liner fact, change is the only constant in this world. The bridge was the pride of America when a destructive hurricane hit America, sweeping away all the roads and bridges. In keeping with the survival of the fittest, the Choluteca Bridge stood there strong and impeccable. But soon later, there was a second hurricane which hit the country, and it hit Juan Andrés badly, and the bridge had to learn a lesson this time. All the roads leading to the bridge was washed away completely. The bridge became inaccessible. What's more, due to the heavy rains, the river changed its course. I repeat, the river changed its course and flowed besides the bridge and not under it. As a result, the bridge was no more a pride, but became a bridge to nowhere. The bridge could not adapt itself to change, and so was left alone. As Prakash Iyer puts it in his Business World column, the challenge for us is that we get focused on creating the best solution to a given problem. We forget that the problem itself might change. Built to last might have been a popular mantra, but built to adapt could be the way to go. So I think, ladies and gentlemen, in this new era, we need to make sure that the problem statements are going to change. They're not going to remain, you know, same all the time. And we cannot build bridges which will last forever, because we need to keep in the back of our minds that the river itself might course, you know, change its course in the course of time. So with these thoughts, I would like to hand it over to Mr. Satyakam, who will moderate this session and take it forward. Thank you once again.
Good morning, everyone. Well, thank you, Hari, for your opening remarks and reminding us all of this story of Bridge Choluteca. It's a very popular story, but I think it's also very important to keep reminding ourselves of that if we don't adapt, this is where we may end up. Well, welcome everyone to this panel discussion, Industry Next Advantage Tamil Nadu. I think there could be no better time to have a panel discussion on this topic than today. Hari just talked about 2020. I think this is one year which we always will remember in our lives. I always take this as a year with the most learnings we could have in a given year. We will be constantly reminded that we have to stay humble and grounded, at the same time be adaptable and resilient. Now, a crisis of this magnitude, when it strikes, also leaves a lasting impression on how we lead our lives and do our businesses. And that's why the topic of what next? What we have been doing may still be fine, but may not be enough, or may deprive the changing trends in consumer behavior or industry. And that's why this topic of what next for Tamil Nadu. And before I go into that topic, I would like to talk about the advantage which Tamil Nadu offers. And I will start by sharing some statistics with all of you. Well, Tamil Nadu is the second largest state economy in India. The GDP growth in Tamil Nadu has always been higher than what India has seen. In fact, the data I have says 7.9% against that time, 6.8% what India had. So we have been leading India in terms of growth. We account for 7% FDI inflows into India. We account for 46% of automotive exports from India, and more than 30% of automobile production anyway happens in the state of Tamil Nadu. We also have 40% of total yarn production in India, which happens in the state, and 16% of India's electronic output. Tamil Nadu is also a leader in IT and IT-enabled services in India, and we have more than 7 lakh registered MSMEs in the state. So all this data points out to how developed Tamil Nadu is as an industrial economy. Well, we are a power surplus state with 32.3 gigawatt installed capacity. And we are a national leader in wind energy and fifth largest solar operating capacity in the country with 14.2 gigawatt installed. And what is also very surprising is we're not just age-old economy. We have the highest bandwidth of 14.8 terabytes per second amongst the Indian states. And that shows Tamil Nadu is leading on all fronts. We have so far about 39 industrial clusters and 44 special economic zones in the state, which is the largest in our country. So you can see all this data proves that Tamil Nadu has really done well when it comes to bringing industry and making them flourish in doing their businesses. I will also like to share my personal experience of being in Tamil Nadu. Daimler, a company which I represent, chose Tamil Nadu as our home. We've been here for more than 10 years now, and we have really benefited from being here. I always say that this is one of the best decisions which we took when we came to India. Apart from having very capable and talented engineering resources, we have very peaceful labor relations in the state, proximity to the port are some of the benefits which I think all of us enjoy when we do business here. Now, taking account from 2020, will that be enough? What we have achieved in Tamil Nadu, is it also relevant for next 10 to 20 years? And especially taking relevance from what will change in our business and lives due to COVID. We've all seen digitalization has picked up tremendous pace in our businesses and the way we do our meetings. We have seen that the digital economy is getting more and more accelerated. In fact, there are studies which say that in the next decade, 70% of our revenues will be enabled by digital economy. Taking account of that fact, I think we have to talk really today about what should Tamil Nadu do or what India as a country should do in order to embrace those technologies, in order to make sure that we are able to bring investments into our state and create more employment and wealth for the people of Tamil Nadu. So without wasting further time, I will now start the discussion with the panelists. I would like to welcome all of you from my side as well. And my first question, or I would like to bring on stage Mr. Samik Roy. I think he's joining us online. Samik, hi. I will ask you to talk about two things. The first one is, if you look at the frontier technologies and you also take the aspect of growth and sustainable development, we believe that these technologies hold immense potential to improve the lives of our people. They foster growth, prosperity, and also bring environmental sustainability, which I think is need of the hour. So according to you, how well is India adopting to these frontier technologies? What needs to be done? That's the first aspect, which I would like you to talk about. And the second is, we have heard that during the pandemic, Microsoft helped organizations by giving them free technology access for 6 months. And you've not only put India, but also global experience on the map by doing that. Can you share your experience on how did that go by? Over to you, Samik.
Sure. I just wanted to do a quick audio check. You are able to hear me and see me?
You are on mute, Samik. We heard you just now, Samik.
Are you able to hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. Right. So thanks, and thanks for inviting me. Well, this actually is a true example of how India is adopting to technology. So let me take 4 or 5 minutes to talk about it, and I will try to combine the two of them by giving lots of examples. So I'll talk about how Microsoft and Indian companies partner together. And I will take so many examples of companies in India, which will give us a flavor of how ready is India. So first, let me start with this. This was a real opportunity for Microsoft to help India in many ways. We partnered and we are still working with many organizations to help them bounce back across three phases. We call this the respond phase, a recover phase, and a reimagine phase of how organizations will change as we come out of COVID. I want to talk about the fact that this whole situation actually grounded us to our mission. And just to remind everybody, our mission is to empower every person and every organization on the planet to do more. So as we saw organizations working tirelessly through the crisis, we partnered to try and ensure that every organization can stand on their feet and work does not stop. You know, during these unprecedented times, there is also a silver lining to the clouds. And that silver lining to the clouds is called digital transformation. The world, as well as India, actually saw about 2 years of digital transformation happen in the past couple of months. And I'll give you many examples. Whatever happened with all of these restrictions, we saw that it forced organizations and people to think of real possibilities. You know, I was hearing the previous speaker speak about this. It started pushing the realms of thinking. It's a very classic example of necessity is the mother of invention. And organizations and people started executing on aspects which we never thought of before. And here came the role of technology, because technology actually helped. Now, the interesting fact is that the technology was always there, and many of these features and functionalities were there, but they were never consumed the way it is being consumed today. So let's take examples. Let's take citizen, the common citizen today, okay, and in the past 1 year. Now, grandparents connected with children and their grandchildren across different parts of India using technology. During the lockdown, when we were all in the closed walls of our home, we ordered the daily groceries using technology. We received the goods using technology. We paid using technology. And if you just join the dots, this is the start of digital India. This is the digital economy, which people have been talking about. Let's go a step deeper, you know. When we look at the organization perspective, so I'm moving from a citizen consumer to an organization perspective, all companies use technology across what I would say three broad use cases: remote healthcare, remote learning, and remote working. And I'll take a minute on each one of them. If you take at remote healthcare, many healthcare organizations, of course, were teaching the medical professional new skills of how to deal with patients. But they also reimagined the way how they will treat their patients irrespective of a location. For example, we partnered with Apollo Hospital and we introduced teleconsultancy and telemedicine that came to life. Now, what did that do? It meant that a patient needing medical treatment in Dehradun could actually connect with the senior cardiologist at Apollo Hospitals in Chennai without undertaking any travel. So it saves time, it saves cost. The person does not need to come to Chennai and find a place and a location to stay, and yet the patient gets access to the best treatment. Let me take another example. This is Ganga Medical Center. It's a specialty hospital in Coimbatore. This organizes hand and microsurgery operative conferences every year. Now, with travel getting restricted, the teaching got suspended because of the enforced closure. And the hospital started to explore new ways to continue the course, right? So we at Microsoft partnered with them, and we worked with the chairman of Department of Plastic Surgery, Dr. Sabapathy. So they used a technology called Microsoft Teams, and they helped them telecast the live surgery across the world. They did about 20 hours of live surgical demonstration, which was possible every single day. They demonstrated 21 procedures conducted across 4 operation theaters. And this was telecast to 550 surgeons across 27 countries. Right? And while this telecast was happening, all of these recipients could actually have an interactive dialogue with the surgeons while the entire procedure was being conducted. And what made it possible was technology. Just a quick check, you all can still hear me and see me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, right. Now, how did this all of this happen? Now, on the background, there were videographers, right, which provided the live feed with special audio and video equipment, which was installed in these four operating theaters. And then the live feed came into Microsoft Teams, and then using a functionality called Microsoft Streams, it was extended to the global audience all the way from Australia to Argentina. Okay? And that's all possible because there is technology. Now, if you look at, let me just move from remote healthcare to remote education, right? Now, again, technology enabled remote learning. Now, while many people saw and think that remote learning was just about an online class, where a physical class got changed to an online class, that was not it. That's just the start. Where digital transformation came in is where institutions, schools, colleges, universities actually automated the entire system. They automated collaboration between the management and the faculty. They did rostering of the faculty and the teachers. And then the same system also did timetable management of the students. Right? Via the collaborative platform of Microsoft Teams, they could not only collaborate and communicate between themselves, but this became an online class, and the same platform became a collaboration tool with the parents. So the parents, the teachers, and the students could all collaborate together using technology, which was not possible before, even though the technology was there. And we worked with many organizations, the Dhirubhai Ambani International School, the British School, the Akash University, RDCT, Delhi Public School, and I can give you many examples. And the most interesting example, which I'm sure will catch the attention of the audience, was a Kamala Nehru Public School, which is actually in Phagwara in North. And we had 65 students across the villages of Phagwara who used technology and mobile phones with upgraded data, which the school provided along with the government, to actually have online classes. And there were methods in which they kept the class very, very engaged, and we got excellent feedback from parents. And I want to now talk about the last aspect. So I spoke about very quickly remote healthcare, the example of Apollo as well as Ganga Hospital. I gave the example of remote learning, which there are many schools and organizations. Now let me come to the commercial world, the organization, right? The commercial world was all about remote working. What we coin as remote anywhere. Now, what does this mean? This is the ability to work from anywhere with anyone. It can be anyone within the organization or your customers or anybody which is beyond the boundaries. With effective collaboration on any device in a secured environment. Now, I know that's a lot of words, but I will call out the keywords. It's about working from anywhere with anyone. Effective collaboration on any device in a secured environment. And we worked with many organizations across the industries. There were industries which were large and enterprise. They were like the Mahindra & Mahindra, the L&T, Pidilite, Aditya Birla, TCS, Mindtree, and I can name many of them. Okay, from the mid-sized organizations and even small organizations and 5 and 10 member trading houses, right? And I'll just take the last 2 minutes to conclude this. This all started with communication, because that's the first thing people thought about, right? Let me use the technology to communicate. And it's all started with audio visual video conferencing. But that was just the start. The need of the hour was, is, and will be much beyond that, right? And that's where communication needs to work very closely with collaboration, which is beyond a VC. What does it mean? It means that a platform needs to be able to help you to be having calling, meeting, chatting amongst the various employees of an organization wherever you are, right? Irrespective of your location, irrespective of your device. It needs to have a meeting cycle. And what does that mean, right? That means, like, let's say you have a boardroom meeting. The boardroom meeting is not about just people entering the meeting door and exiting the meeting door. There's a lot of work which happens before the boardroom meeting. Why is the boardroom meeting happening? There is documentations out there. There is PowerPoint presentations out there. There is Excel sheets out there. There may be financial papers out there. There's discussion which is happening with people. And then the meeting happens. And then there is the post meeting where this continues. And after some point of time, there is another meeting. So it's a constant journey. Now, if you look at this journey has calling, it has got video conferencing, it has got collaboration, it has got documents which many people work on at the same point of time, what we call as co-authoring and co-editing. And all of this needs to be shared in an environment which needs to be very, very secured, correct? And all of that needs to happen on one platform where the data resides with the customer, the data is secure, the data resides in India. And when you talk about higher levels of effectivity and productivity, which leads to growth, you've got to ensure that even small business processes get automated. And it's the same window from where you can do everything. So you do your emails, you do your calendaring, you do your calling, you do your meetings, you create these documents, you exchange these documents, you share these documents, correct? And you continue. And that's how technology basically seeped in as the core of every organization, whether it was healthcare, education institute, or commercial organization, or citizens. And that's how we helped many people across India. Now, I know that's a long-winded answer, but that's how we helped organizations. And I gave so many examples where it shows the readiness of the organizations to challenge themselves, adopt technology which is present and is innovating itself as we are also learning. And then they take these innovations to be better and better, to be productive. And that is the reimagined phase of as we go come out of COVID. So I stop here for any questions, and or I can come back later.
Well, thank you, Samik. That was a very, very interesting perspective. And as we said earlier, due to COVID, a lot of things change around us. And we were using these technologies on a day-to-day basis, were not aware really how much is happening in the background. And you touched upon three topics, learning, healthcare, and collaboration. I was particularly fascinated by this collaborative platform which you talked about. A lot of organizations are using similar things, but they are not integrated in the way you described. I'm sure this is how it will redefine the new workplace or workplace of the future. So
absolutely.
Well, let's move on. I look at you, Mr. Raghuraman. You are at the helm of affairs in Tata Consultancy Services, the largest IT company. And Samik talked about these frontier technologies from everyday life, how they are making inroads and what would change. I want you to touch the aspect of manufacturing or what happens in the industrial environment. We've heard a lot about Industry 4.0, digitalization, IoT, 3D printing, you know, there's a long list. And there is always a hesitation, will it make sense for India? What is really needed in India? What will make sense? So if you can just touch upon how should India adopt these technologies in the manufacturing space?
Thanks, Mr. Arya. Good morning. I think as you started off this panel, I think Tamil Nadu has now in a very unique position to lead the industrial growth. It is in the second place in the GDP. We are doing around 300 billion, I think, and the industry constitutes around 25%. And there is a lot of opportunities that presents in front of us in sectors like automotive, in electronics, in many, many industries for Tamil Nadu to lead from the next generation perspective. What really has Tamil Nadu has done in the past, in the last 10 years, 20 years, in terms of bringing that level of industrialization, bringing the level of supply chain and excellence in quality, adoption of principles like TQM and I think 2019 TVS Group got the Deming Award. So a lot of the quality and excellence process, supply chain, ecosystem, all of that has been very methodically, very systematically developed in Tamil Nadu, and that is giving us a very good foundation for the next growth. Now, coming to the next growth, which is actually driven by two important, when we say frontiers is where the emerging technology come to a point of implementation, and we look at it, how do we really take that technology and adapt it? And whether it is in the sectors like electronics, whether it is in the sectors like automotive, there is a whole lot of disruption is happening, whole lot of systems like electric vehicle, autonomous cars, many, many things are coming. And we are now in a very unique stage to jumpstart this, because we already laid the foundation as in Tamil Nadu, and actually lead from the front. So for that next generation of smart manufacturing, how do we build excellence in manufacturing is very critical. And that aspects of it will have three, four elements, like it has to offer the highest level of flexibility, highest level of quality, and of course the highest, you know, or the competitive cost position that we can carry. I think all these dimensions, the flexibility, the ability for the ecosystem and the development of supply chain and adoption of new technology and the cost competitiveness all have to come together for us to leap start this manufacturing for the next generation. So towards that, as you rightly put, that technologies like Industry 4.0, Internet of Things, are actually enabling multiple industries in the sectors like product discrete manufacturing to process manufacturing. Many, many industries, utilities, can adopt this Industry 4.0 technologies to jumpstart it. The question comes is, what these technologies really mean in terms of India context, and is it affordable for our industries to adopt? And it really has the benefit and the return on investment that it can claim to be. The answer to it is, first of all, these technologies have now become mature, and it is it can be adopted by any industry in India. The type of technology platform, whether the IoT platforms, where you put sensors, collect data and process the data and build analytics and AI, they are all available, both from companies like Microsoft AWS and other companies. And multiple platforms are available and the choice can be made. And there are people who are skilled enough to architect a system like that and implement for our industries in India. I will give some two, three examples of how this is really making a significant difference. We being part of the Tata Group, we work with one of the group company called Voltas. Apart from the domestic air conditioners, Voltas has a huge business around industrial cooling business, HVAC business. And they have huge chillers that operates large buildings for their cooling facilities. And these chillers are spread in close to around 1,000 sites in India, from remote towns to urban centers to many places. And today, Voltas has fixed sensors and diagnostic devices in all these chillers. And we collect the data around the coolant temperatures, ambient temperatures, conditions of the compressors, conditions of the humidity, and many such parameters. Continuously on a real-time basis, it gets transmitted to their headquarters in Bombay, and they are able to monitor all these chillers sitting in Bombay and be able to understand what performance is. And also, if there are any potential failures, they are able to predict, because we have built some intelligent models on top of it. And think of it, Voltas has adopted to this technology not after COVID. They have done this 2 years ahead of COVID. And slowly 100 sites they started expanding to 300 sites, again brought it to 600 sites. So this is that technology has really helped in COVID, because you can't send people all over the place traveling, and we have to monitor that remotely. So I think it's a very strong example of how an Indian industry has adopted this technology. They have a platform, they have a sensor gateway, they collect the data and able to do that. And I can quote another example very quickly, is Triveni. They make this gas turbines for many of the industries, and their CEO is very particular that they want to adopt the next generation technology. In India, in Bangalore, they have actually adopted all the turbines installed in India, around 300 of them have sensors and gateway. It is sending data to their central office in Bangalore. They are doing diagnostic maintenance and support center. In many other industries, we are working with Titan, where we have implemented the smart factory solutions using four main assets of Industry 4.0. We call that as smart assets, how we can maintain the assets, do predictive modeling. You have smart workers, how we can enable the workers to be more productive, and technologies like AR, VR, and smart supply chain, which is basically to integrate with the supply chain. And great example is Hindustan Zinc, where they have a completely integrated solutions from truck coming into the facility. Sensors will do the weighbridge, and the whole RFID tags around the assets. Everything is integrated with their ERP platform and SAP. A very beautiful example of a smart supply chain. Similarly, smart operations in terms of how we can look at various operational parameters. These technologies, I repeat, is very important for us to lead the next generation of manufacturing. And TN has the best foundation, and we can build it. And we don't have to have any level of hesitation whether these technologies are relevant or can be adopted. It can be adopted right now. And right at this moment, you can go live for a plant, or you can take it in phases or in full-blown mode. I think this is important for us. For the, I think Tamil Nadu government said they want 15% growth as part of the new industry policy. If we really want to give shape to that, adoption of these smart manufacturing, these technologies, right now the solutions, the providers, integrators, technologies are available, and we want the industry to come, have those conversation and take it forward.
Thank you, Mr. Raghuraman. I think you touched upon very important aspects and also tried to clear doubts, which are many times in the mind of people, especially in manufacturing, that does it make sense for India? And you've highlighted some areas, or the focus areas, I would say, where we could really try that out. We could use this for performance management of our equipment, also managing predictive failures, because if we don't do that in time, the collateral damage is much more. So it's more a cost avoidance as well. Well, moving on, I would now come to you, Mr. Kumar Vembu. The name of your company, which you represent, Go Frugal Technologies, is also a thought-provoking name. We were just talking about how the technology is making inroads into services, into manufacturing, in our daily lives. What that will eventually lead to is creation of a digital economy. And we want to learn from you how that will happen and how that will help in value creation for the society and for the business.
Thank you, sir. Very happy to be here, and very thankful to Mr. Hari and the CII for inviting me. So I think, the moment we talk about the digital economy, I see many people have some fear, because many companies that have established themselves with a big name in the digital economy, they all lose a lot of money. So people think that if we want to participate in the digital economy, we have to first invest and lose a lot of money, right, in marketing, in creating a brand, and in customer acquisition costs, and we have to have a unit economics that is not sustainable. So many times, especially when you read some of the newspaper reports that talk about astronomical valuations and, the poor financial performance of the same companies, like in Tamil, we say, siruga katti peruga vaal. So we start thinking that, this is not for us, and we want to sort of stay away from it because we are doing a profitable business. So the first thing we must understand is that, by going digital, our profitability can actually increase, and our peace of mind can improve a lot. To me, digital is all about, achieving completely frictionless operations, completely frictionless customer experience, you know, completely frictionless compliance. So in all aspects of the business, whatever you can think of, completely frictionless supply chain management, completely frictionless vendor management, you know, so completely frictionless experience with the banks. So that means, you know, if we adopt digital, you know, business is going to become a lot simpler. Business is going to, you know, for the people working with us, we are going to expect less skills. So life is going to be easier for the people. It will be easier to actually onboard people and train them and make them productive and replace them. You know, all of them are going to be easy. So that is something we have to keep in mind. You know, we should not, you know, form an opinion based on, you know, how the digital leaders, some of them, you know, lose money and things like that. But look at the real benefits and see how, you know, every company can digitally transform themselves, right? Make themselves relevant for the digital economy. So that also puts a question on what do we mean by then this digital transformation, right? So it, to me, you know, it is all about how can we make, you know, if we do some product or service, how can we first make ourselves discoverable, right? So that means like people may find you, you know, for example, when the only way people will find you is you had an agent in some other city. So there were people who were going and meeting people and explaining, or people find you in trade show and things like that. Then, you know, we started, you know, using platforms like Just Dial or IndiaMart and all to reach out to customer, right? And in digital, the avenues for, you know, where customers can discover you can be a lot more, right? For example, if somebody is doing some unique products, right? Today, are they available in Amazon, right? Or can they be found in Amazon, you know, then it can boost their sales. To give you an example, like about during COVID, I switched from a toothpaste to a Siddhar, you know, tooth powder called the Siddhar Karuvela Patti. It was available in a local Natu Marundu, you know, the country medicine shop in Thiruvanmiyur. Then I was curious whether is it there in Amazon. And I did a search and it's there in Amazon. I can order in Amazon. And it's actually 10% cheaper in Amazon than what the local medicine shop sells it. So then I came to know of this product when I went and inquired in the shop once. Right, so I knew it only now, but the guys in Amazon knew it and they have already listed it. And the company that is manufacturing this tooth powder, you know, is now, you know, I hope they have listed it not only in India but globally. That means that what is a product, small product, that is available only in, you know, the country medicine shops, you know, in your neighborhood, you know, they are now available, you know, at least across India and hopefully across the globe, right? So think about how that company's, you know, market has expanded, how the customers of that product, right? They don't have to worry now. You know, if I move out of Thiruvanmiyur and move to any other state or any other city or any other country, I know that, you know, that product is just a couple of clicks away for me to order. So basically by going digital, for this, you know, Siddhar Karuvela Patti tooth powder company, right? The market has expanded now. So anybody, any loyal customer continues to be their customer. I have already referred that product to few people and hopefully many of them have ordered in Amazon. So they don't have to tell me I'll buy it when I come to Chennai or you buy and ship or something like that. So that is, you know, one simple example of how a very specialized product has increased its market, across the globe. So that discoverability is very important. So for discoverability, we have to look at all the platforms in which we have to make our product available, wherever consumers will search for our product, right? We have to be there. And we have to be there in a cost-effective manner we have to be there in a manner that being available does not increase our cost of acquisition and make us unsustainable business. So, and the second thing is, once we are available there, how do we promote? So promotion becomes very important, right? Today, even social commerce is becoming a reality where there are many businesses that are available or that are promoted in Instagram, Facebook, and even Google Shop or a lot of other platforms like that. So how can business be promoted? That plays a very important role, because today, especially after COVID, the first thing people check out, especially in urban areas and by smartphone users, is is the product, if the product is promoted digitally, then it gets larger attention, larger inbound leads, right? That is the second aspect. And the third aspect is the perception, right? Even after the product is promoted, people can look at what is the rating, what do the customers say. So now I don't have to know somebody in my social circle to know about the reputation of a product, right? So I can I can find the social reputation of the product in the marketplace in which I find the product, or in a lot of other places. In fact, over the last 2-3 years, my decision on where to stay, where to eat, and what to order have been influenced about 70-80% by what I see as the online rating, the number of people who have rated that product or service, and what they have rated and how they have rated it, right? And correlating that with the visual images of the product or service, you come to a conclusion on whether that is credible or not. So there is an element of judgment there, but this perception, building a very favorable perception, is very important. Because what's happening today is, especially in Tamil Nadu, many of us have always believed that our product speaks for ourselves, right? One thing that we have to change in the digital economy is we have to make sure our customers also start speaking for us, in not only to you. If some customer calls you and appreciates you or sends you a private email or a private message saying your product or service is awesome, we should be a little shameless. See, this is where I find many of the Tamil Nadu entrepreneurs a little lacking, right? We always think we should not praise ourselves, right? We should not request this to customer. If they want, they will go and say it. But we should be a little more open in requesting people to rate us in the platforms that matter, right? So that our social reputation in the online platforms is higher, whatever product you deal with, right? Because today many businesses are list, even if somebody finds you in your India Mart, they will go and check first about what is your reputation, other sites, right? So it is very, very important to build a reputation, right? And in that context, to build a reputation, it may also be very important to have some influencers talk about your product and you promote that. Because in every market, there are influencers, there are people who are very credible, there are people who are, whose word can actually, give more weight than, in the mind of a customer who is making a decision, right? So we have to have influencers and customers talk about our product, it's not a very scripted talk, but it has to be a very honest opinion about our product and service, which addresses the concerns of other customers, right? Because that is a very important aspect of the digital economy. So once we do this, we are discoverable and we have this promotion, and we manage the perception of the people, they may express the interest. So people get interested in that product or service. From that moment on, the experience should be totally frictionless. See, that's where, you know, digital plays a very important role, right? In many, many of our businesses, you know, the moment an inquiry comes, you know, people will run to the owner or people will run to their manager and ask them, what should I quote or what should I respond or something like that, you know? We must, you know, if we want to digitally transform, you know, every time people come and ask us for help, you know, we have to ask, why are they coming to us? Why are they not empowered? Because in digital, everybody have to be empowered. If somebody is, you know, looking for me to service the customer, when a customer is in front of them, if they are looking for me to respond to the customer, if they are looking for me to solve the problem of the customer, I should actually feel ashamed of running that business, because that's not the business for the future. You know, because the moment, you know, without my, you know, my instruction or my assistance or my approval, they can't serve the customer, then, you know, we are not a digital business, right? So the number one, you know, if there is so much clarity in the way they are empowered and the process and everything, it can easily be automated. You know, if there are so many things where, you know, you will make a decision based on your mood and based on your context and things like that, then your business is inherently unscalable, right? Remember, there are small, you know, kirana stores where the boy working in the shop cannot do a transaction without talking to the owner about the price or discount or whatever. And you can contrast that with an Amazon, right, which is doing probably millions of transactions a day without nobody ever talking to anybody, right? So we have to always have that in mind, right? We can also have it in our mind, our you know, cab hiring and cab riding experience. You know, when we used to engage a travel, how many calls we used to make the travel agency and to the driver to start our journey and end our journey and finish the payment, versus how it is in Uber and Ola, right? Nobody ever have to actually talk to anybody to book a ride or complete a ride or whatever, right? So we have to look at our all our business processes to make sure they are completely frictionless. And this frictionless experience is not only for the customers, but for all our employees, for all our suppliers, for all our service providers, for even our transactions with the banks and everybody, even for our compliance. So in my opinion, our government has been very proactive. You know, as a company that is serving small businesses more, I can say government is driving a lot of these transformation because, you know, they made e-filing of VAT, they made GST filing, income tax filing, faceless assessment. So government is adopting digital much faster than private companies are doing in Tamil Nadu. So what can accelerate our growth and increase our productivity? You know, I think our growth and productivity are very highly linked because, you know, Tamil Nadu has one of the lowest unemployment rates in India, and all our businesses find it hard to find local talent, and we keep importing a lot of talent from other states in India. So that means if we can't improve the productivity, we have to bring more and more people into Tamil Nadu, and you know, that will become more and more cost of labor will go up. So increasing productivity is very important. For that, all the business processes, whether it is with customer or suppliers or employees, all have to become frictionless. So if we do all these, you know, in my view, you know, we will our businesses will digitally transform, and we can all enjoy the benefits of that digital transformation in the form of increased peace of mind and higher profitability. Thank you again for the opportunity. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Mr. Vembu. In a very simple but emphatic way, you have articulated how do we prepare the organization or the business for digitalization. You know, many times we think it's about buying hardware and installing software. I think there are a lot more things which have to be done in the organization to practice this sustainably, like empowerment is one aspect which you picked up. Let's move on and let's pick up a different focus area. You know, a sustainable development also needs to address urban versus rural divide, right? We know we are unequal in a lot of terms when it comes to urban economy versus a rural economy. And we have with us Mr. Satish Kumar. He is the managing director of Milky Mist Dairy Foods Private Limited, one of the very successful company in the dairy food business. According to you, Mr. Satish Kumar, what are the challenges which we have? And if Tamil Nadu has to address those challenges, how should we go about that?
Good afternoon. Thank you, CIA, for giving me the opportunity, wonderful opportunity to deliver my speech, combining growth, urban and rural economics. Milky Mist is the largest dairy product, 100% dairy product company, 100% dairy product, value-added dairy product manufacturing company. Only dairy product company in India which controls the entire operation from farm to fork, and also owns 100% supply chain logistics. Every day we procure 6 lakh liters of milk from 60,000 farmers. In that, digitization is plays a big role in rural economics. Fully automated and organized collection centers at the village level, which gives us real-time data online, always make farmers' income more sustainable to ensure the transparency and accuracy in our procurement system through prompt payment. We are the second largest private dairy in Tamil Nadu procuring milk. Average, we transfer per day nearly 2 crore to the 2 crore rupees to the farmer, which translates almost 650 crore per annum to directly to the farmer's bank account. No cash dealing in our account, each and every farmer directly we transfer the money. And we urban, the particularly in the sales side, if we take, we developed a Salesmatic app. Almost we have more than 14,000 chillers in each and every Kirana shops. To maintain the cold chain, and we install a Salesmatic app, which salespeople can able to track each and every chiller, the temperature, each and the maintenance of the chiller and the product maintenance. We recently set up a greenfield dairy plant spread over 57 acres in Perundurai near Erode, with an investment of 550 crore through the support of nationalized banks. And we gone with completely industry 4 automation, first of its kind in Indian dairy industry. We gone with entire plant industry 4 automation. Milky Mist always believes in the latest technology and ready to adapt the new technology from time to time. One example in the during COVID period, one of the fully automated the butter packing machine, which we ordered almost 15 months before last 2020 January, we received the machine, which is the very costly machine, which is the best machine in the world. It eliminate almost 30 people in the production, and we struggle a lot to install the machine during this period. If you take particularly digitization plays a big role, and also industry 4 automation developed a lot, because initially the German company not interested to install the machine without their German engineer to come here in front of them. We have to install, but after 4-5 months we given the guarantee, and whatever we take the risk on our side, and finally because of the industry 4 automation, we installed a camera, and they avoided almost 4-5 engineers to come in for work 1 or 2 months, and successfully we commissioned two machines in this COVID period. 10 years back and now, if you take rural, road connectivity improved a lot, better reachability to markets, rural spending grown in double-digit growth, whereas urban spending is going to be a limited factor. Various reasons like cost of living, pollution, etc. unemployment gone down drastically over the period. Now farmers getting sustainable income through cattle farming. Even in COVID period, we don't declare any milk holiday to in the procurement. We Milkim is closely working with farmers in the village level to make farming more sustainable through developing water bodies, educating clean milk production, and so on. Once again, thanks to all CIA members for giving me the wonderful opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Satish Kumar. That was really wonderful to see some glimpses from your production. We hardly saw people there and everything fully automated and mechanized. Well, let's move on, and I would come back to you, Mr. Samik Roy. I hope you're online with us.
I am live with you. Are you able to hear me?
Can you hear me, Samik?
Yes, I can hear you.
Perfect. Well, I want you to touch upon another aspect which is related to digitalization or digital economy. And those aspects are, what about cyber security and privacy getting compromised? Or the work-life balance, which we have seen has struggled, especially when all our interactions have gone online. So what are those challenges, and how do you think that these should be addressed?
Sure. Okay. So first of all, you know, let me start from where I stopped, and you summarized it very well, where you spoke about that, look, all of this technology exists, but they should not be in silos. It should be one integrated platform. And just to summarize that, we talked about communication, we talked about collaboration, we talked about extensibility, we talked about security, all happening out of one platform, right? It's not just a video conference or just an audio call. And what you said is very, very right. You know, India, if you looked at reports, and Meiji came out with this reports, the government came out with this reports, had 4x the number of ransomware and cybersecurity attacks, because the systems were just vulnerable. You know, people were working from home, they were working out of devices which were not organizations' devices, they were working out of their own devices. So how do we secure everything? So there are two aspects which are important. The first aspect is that security should be within the core of the solution, and it's not an afterthought, right? So it's not that I first create a solution and then I put a security layer around it. It's important is whether the security is ingrained in the product in itself. So that's an important aspect, right? So when you look at our solutions, and one of the reasons why lots and lots of customers took our solutions is because there is security within the product and there is security around the product. Okay? So you start the computer, you have Windows, and Windows does security. It does endpoint data protection. You've got advanced security. You've got threats. You've got ransomware and malware attacks which can be prevented. And security goes all the way from the front end, which is the device, all the way to the back end, which is where systems run on our data center in India. And that's where your privacy norms come in, because the data is residing in the India data center. So you have got access to it. So that takes care of security. And we also have the solution, which is MDM. In our case, it's called Intune, which secures the device. So from the device to the solution, I talk about putting data on shared centers, which we call as OneDrive, which is there in the India data center with security all around it, which is what gave a lot of confidence to our customers to adopt the solution. And I want to quickly talk about the second point, which in my opinion will be the most important thing to keep in mind as organizations limp out and start running as with the economy and as COVID dies out, which is the work-life balance. So one of the aspects that we noticed is that the number of hours people started devoting to work increased phenomenally. And people don't realize, but traveling time stopped. Where did the traveling times go? Yeah, when we moved from one meeting to the other meeting, let's say this particular meeting, I'm not there physically in person. Now, if I'd been there physically in person, there would have been a travel time to the venue, there would have been a travel time back, I would have been in a hotel, I would have had lunch somewhere. But in this case, I will stop this video conference and I will get into the next video conference. So those travel times got converted into work times. We were all working from home. We were all working in scenarios where we had to manage our balance our families, we had parents, we had children, many people had newborn children, and they were all catering to all of these along with work. So the stress levels increased, which anyway were high, but with the work-life balance, they increased further. And what we did is that we did research and we looked at how are people using the technology and how is it impacting them. And we detected brain waves, okay, along with work, because we were able to catch all of them with machine learning. Because when you look at emails, you use Microsoft Exchange. When you're using Word, PowerPoint, Excel, you're using Microsoft Office 365. When anybody is trying to attack you, it's the Microsoft security which is preventing you. When you start on your computers, you're using Windows. So we were using the telemetry, okay, which is publicly available, and looking at how it impacts brain waves. And this has happened irrespective across the world when people are adopting technology. And we saw that there was mental fatigue. Let me give you very simple examples here related. When online classes started, the first request which came from all the teachers and the institutes is, oh, we see 40 students in a class, but we need 40 panes to be able to see all the students whether they're paying attention. Great, we provided 40 panes, some people put 100 panes. But just think of it, is the brain designed to look at 40 panes at any one point of time? And your mind is quickly scanning through all of it, your eyeballs are scanning through it while you're trying to teach, and teaching online is a new way of teaching itself, so you're doing whiteboarding. So you've gotten mental fatigue. And what we did is we brought all the learnings back into the technology. So today, when you are doing a class, you can actually create a scenario of a classroom. When you are doing a boardroom, you actually see people seated in a boardroom environment. If I was to see this audience using Microsoft Teams technology, I would have seen it as an auditorium, or as the way the audience looks at it, instead of having 40 or 100 panes, if there are 100 people sitting in the audience and trying to go and look at everybody's body language. And that helps to actually decrease fatigue. The last thing, and I will end with it, right? And this is where analytics and machine learning helps. Because again, you're doing it from one integrated platform, all the way from productivity to collaboration to security to sharing and teamwork and calling meeting devices. It's actually capturing everything that you're doing. So it will give you automatic prompts to say, you don't have enough resting times in your day. And it goes and creates calendar settings and saying, take a rest. We have tied with hands with organizations which is into mindfulness. So it will ask you to go into these deep breathing exercises or do these movement exercises to be able to energize your body. Right? It actually scans your emails and says, hey, don't worry. I will keep a scan of your email and says, you actually gave these 5 commitments to people. It's been 7 days. You may want to revisit it. And these ones haven't been done. Okay. It keeps track of the fact that, look, I'm doing this video conference, but at the same point of time, I'm doing an email. So it will give me and my manager and HR, based on policies and processes of information sharing, that the person is overworked and he is doing emails along with a teleconferencing call or with phone calls. And then you can start segregating the two. And then you get this information, right? You can actually put in systems in place and policies in place to be able to look at work-life balance. And that would help employees to be sustainable. Because the gentleman from Grofugel said a very beautiful thing. It is not about streamlining processes for a customer, but it's also streamlining processes for a partner. And it's also important to streamline processes for people and employees within the organization, because that's going to be your biggest asset along with technology. Back to you.
Thank you, Samik. That was quite interesting. Now we will have an even more intelligent reminder in the mails with us. Well, I would like to take a pause here and open the floor for the audience. If you have a question for the panelists, we would be then happy to take it. Can we also have a mic for the audience? There's one there. If you could just shortly introduce yourself, state the question, and to whom you want to address this question to.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. I'm Ranjit from Hygia. Thanks to the panel for an interesting discussion. There are a few points that I would like to put forth and then a question. First of all, it is ironic that the US has 150 million as its working population, and India, if it adds another 150 million, it will reach about 3% unemployment levels. And the two core issues that you see which are not addressed in terms of growth that is happening is the outdated labor laws, whether it is industrial relations or occupational health and safety, as well as the structural reforms when it comes to these. The next point again is in terms of addressing the core aspect of the first point, as I said, was with respect to labor laws. The second point is with respect to health. So although we are implementing a lot of these 4.0 technologies, which can look at India A and India B, and what we mean by India A and B are the populations which have a GDP of USD 3000 and more. India C, the population has a GDP of $3,000 or less. So only if we look at health can the life of everybody in India improve, and only then it will result in livelihood and growth. So what can industry do in general to look at how we can look at streamlining labor laws and also look at health in a more proactive way? Because even though the corona has made us more economically efficient and proficient in the ways of working, when we look at our health, still many companies take a very short-term approach when it comes to health. There are only a handful of companies who have looked at healthcare for their employees in a very proactive manner and are looking at it from a resilience perspective. Thank you.
Well, you would like to take that question? Or? Okay. Well, you didn't address it to anyone. I will start, and maybe if you want to add comments, I will hand over to you. You are absolutely right. You pointed towards some of the things where we really need to move in tandem if we need to embrace all that change which is happening. Well, we all have heard that the government has worked on new labor codes, which should come into effect from 1st of April. They seem to be different from what we have seen so far. Are they really addressing all the aspects which needed to be addressed? It's a question mark. And that is something which we have to see now from April onwards. How does that go? Coming to the aspect of health, or I would say rather well-being of employees, also has been an area where I believe corporates can definitely do more. We need not only address the challenges they have, but need to create an environment where they can work with happiness and passion, keeping a good balance between taking care of their health and, of course, work. I would just point out what we have been doing, and I acknowledge more can be done. During the period of COVID, we had three full-time doctors, which are anyway working in our company, and they were in constant touch with all the employees and their families. We also made sure that we had a mental health counseling helpline given to our employees, knowing that many of them are working under stressful conditions, and now there is a health crisis going on. And many employees came forward and took the benefit of that. The other thing which we did is, and we were doing that before COVID started, is we've seen yoga really benefits maintenance of good health and overall development of an individual. So we have been providing regular yoga classes to our people. And during COVID, we even opened that to their families. Of course, it happened online, but this greatly helped in that people went through this crisis in a better way. Well, these are some of the things which we have done. And if you would like to add something from your perspective, please go ahead.
I want to add, not from the labor law perspective, but technology perspective. I think, especially at the time of COVID, there are many companies who have looked at technology solutions in a way to provide a safety and as well as comfort to the employees. Because there are industries like automotive, there are industries like utilities, where at least minimal staff has to come and resume the plant, resume the operations, they have to work together. So how do we really provide technology-enabled solutions to them to keep them safe, to keep them operate effectively? For example, we have launched one connected workers solutions, and it is in India, many plants have adopted. Worldwide also, many plants have adopted, where it will be able to track the particular employee in terms of as they walk in using a thermal camera in terms of the temperature. And they will always be carrying a tag with them as part of their ID card. And as they travel around their facility, if they come closer to any employee, it will have a recording and also a warning system to maintain the social distance. These records help us because in case there is a suspected infection, we can track down who and all they might have got into contact. So many such solutions are increasingly adopted to provide occupational safety. Even during non-COVID time also, I must add that industries are very actively looking for solutions and implementing such solutions for improving safety of workers. We worked with Tata Steel, which is, you know, the largest steel producer in India, one of the largest, and we developed a smart watch. It's called Kavach, Kavacham, like, no, Kavach. And this watch actually maintains and continuously maintains the workers' vital parameters like pulse and their temperature and many of those parameters. And also it kind of have certain sensors. Suddenly if they had fallen and there is a steep fall, it can actually detect and send alarms. And also there are places where potentially people can get in as a lone employee in a remote location and come in touch with toxic gases and then they swoon, nobody notices it. So there is also a toxic gas detection sensors in that device. A number of solutions, and for example, if people are going in a blind spot and there is a forklift truck or something comes, people get hurt in that process, it has an alarm system to avoid such accidents. A whole lot of such technology-enabled solutions are implemented in various factories. In various modes, people are adopting it, depending upon their need and their preference. And we see that is happening across many industries to improve the safety of workers. Thank you.
Well, I would like to just add a couple of things. See, about 8 years back, what we have done is, for health, creating a psychologically safe work environment is the most important thing. So especially when there are so many changes happening in the market, right? Many times, the changes impact people and make their skills irrelevant. So a lot of people have anxiety about that. So how do we create a psychologically safe environment? Because anxiety and stress is what leads to a lot of health problems. So that means I first sort of changed myself in the sense that there are certain languages I will not use with people in the office. Language that will create fear, language that will increase anxiety, right? So that we first create a psychologically safe environment. So we tell people that we are all in this together, right? And we talk about the challenge and how can we actually get out of this challenge in the best possible manner. Because the moment anxiety is taken out and there is an environment of trust and people feel that we are all one team, right? That itself makes people a lot more healthier. And the second thing we did about 8 years back is we don't call it HR now, right? Human is not a resource, right? So we call it, what was supposed to be a HR head as a people delight manager. Because if you really have to have digital transformation, then every employee should have a frictionless experience in all their transactions or engagement or whatever they do within the company, right? So that means we made it very clear to everybody that we want, we want to give a delightful experience to you in the office. So whatever friction you encounter, you know, you please be open about it, right? And we started measuring the emotion of the people. So the rule of thumb is like you come to office happy and you go home happy, right? You know, so we don't want office to be responsible for your unhappiness. So if there are improvements you have to make, if there are skills you have to acquire, we will be open about telling you that, and we will work with you, assist you to the extent possible, right? So we made that a happiness first culture, not productivity first or profitability first, but happiness first. So that increased the ownership of the people and the sense of belonging, because finally I think many of the health illnesses are mainly because people are unhappy. So we will attack the root of the problem, right? So that is something we did, and we also recruited a wellness manager about 5-6 years back. So yoga and meditation are sort of part of our culture, and all our team meetings, you know, so we start with, if there are more than 3 or 4 people, we start with 5 minutes anapana meditation. This is to calm people's mind so that everybody can listen better, right? And they can spend, they can be more patient. And definitely, I can say it's probably more than 5 years since I have handled any people conflict within the company, because when there is a problem, people always look at it as a, how can we solve it together, right? So if we can bring about that kind of a culture, right, definitely sometimes exceptions happen, but more or less, and I also make sure at least 20% of the time whatever I speak is about health and happiness. So it always stays on top of everybody's mind. So these things have really helped us in making sure at least there is focus on health within the office.
You, what Mr. Kumar Vembu said, I think managing the mind, you solve more than half of the issues. And I think the happiness index which you spoke about is very relevant, especially in Scandinavian countries, where they have, I think, very good work-life balance, and I think they all leave from the office by 4 p.m. Nobody stays beyond that. And the usual philosophy there is if you work overtime or if you stay beyond that 4 or 4:30 in the office, I mean not the factories, it means that you are inefficient. You know, what needs to be done in 8 hours, you will have to do it in 8 hours. And if you, spill over, it just means that you are inefficient and you take more time to complete a given task. But I think the question is very relevant. I think India has a lot more opportunities. Indian corporates have, a lot more duty-bound work to be done in creating, I think, first of all, a safe environment for, workers. Some of the incidences which we have seen in our own state in the last few days, I think, these things need a lot more redressal. I think a safe environment needs to be first built. And I'd just like to touch upon some of the areas which we took up in our textile factories in Madurai, in and around Madurai, where about 2,000 people worked, during the COVID period. So during the, lockdown, obviously, our factories were completely shut. But on May 6th, when we opened up gradually, about 40, 50, and then we moved up slowly to, 100% utilization, we, gave away to all, workers and their families this homeopathy medicine called camphora. And another, drink which we gave was the Kabasura Kudineer, which the health department from Tamil Nadu also advocated. So I think we stuck more with the Indian system of medicine in this. I think just as a preventive action to see how it turns out. And camphora was given to all our, not only to the workers, but also their families. Because their families also need to be safe. Because if, the husband or wife or child, bring this virus home, it's going to affect, all of them, because they live in very small, places, very small dwellings. I should say I think only had about 1 or 2 cases, and that too was asymptomatic. So in a place where so many, people come together and work, we have hostels for our women workers, about 200 of them stay there. Of course, we, cut down the number of people staying in each room. But I think overall, the Indian system, especially, homeopathy and Ayurveda, have been good, systems or the preventive care. We also did give them, you know, doses of, you know, vitamin C and zinc, which also, you know, helped to a certain extent. I think, you know, one area which still a lot more work needs to be done, especially in the manufacturing sector, which employs a lot of women workforce, especially areas like chemicals, textiles, matchmaking. All this has a lot of women workforce, especially in down south region. The nutrition levels of these people working there, you know, especially young girls and, you know, women, is, I think, grossly inadequate. We see a lot of them, you know, by looking at them, they're, you know, malnourished, and they come up with a lot of issues even very early in life, late 20s, late 30s, when they start having children and all that. I think nutrition levels is something that we really need to, you know, focus on. There's a lot, you know, to be done there. I think if canteens in our factories can give more, you know, rich, you know, protein diets, or, you know, kind of have, you know, more pulses, etc., I think this will help out, especially the women workforce to a large extent. And also, you know, creating basic awareness to them on their, you know, health and hygiene issues.
Thank you. Go for the next question. People who are online can also ask questions. You just need to post it on the platform and we'll pick it up.
Are you able to hear me? My name is Bhaskar. I run a startup, just 2 years old, called Siddhan Intelligence. Before posting my question, I just wanted to thank each one of you sitting on the dais for making the difference in my life. Mr. Vembu sir, your Zoho is helping our company to run our systems. And I convinced my wife by preparing chili paneer with the help of Mr. Satish Kumar. And of course, Hari sir, Manangkakravar ninga, engalukku udaiya irundhu. Of course, Satyakam, I use your car, and half of my relatives are working in TCS. And Soumik, I must be very proud of you, what Microsoft has done. People used to ask me, where is your office? I tell it is in Microsoft Teams now. So we don't, all 100% of my employees work in Teams. Okay, coming back, rather it is a question, or rather a concern I just wanted to share. Probably any one of you can suggest us. We recently had a MSME meeting where Franklin and Kumanan and all organized. One of the concerns we raised was the cyber security. Okay, the more digital means we are open, prone to a lot of attacks. It may not be, you know, bigger organization can handle it, because you can deploy a lot of big systems, of course, thanks to Microsoft, because it builds all the products with the heavy security built in. But the problem is, you know, many of them doesn't know how to handle the cyber attacks. This is a very big concern, particularly for the new entrepreneur world, because their focus is something else, whereas they will not be sitting and doing the policing work. And I also surprised and really happy, thanks to Government of Tamil Nadu, they opened close to around 45 cyber police stations. 2 weeks back, I have seen this article. That shows the seriousness of how things are going, where the crimes are moved from where to where. Okay, what is your recommendation? How MSME kind of companies can handle this kind of situation? And how we need to protect our business? That's what my request. Thank you, sir.
Well, thank you for the question.
I think I'll, you know, share one of our personal experiences on this. I think cybersecurity is definitely you know, huge area of concern today. I think my technology is advancing you know, in a very fast pace, but at the same time, we are also having negative issues like you know, cybersecurity concerns. So, in the export trade of textiles, there have been at least half a dozen companies in the last 1 year who have faced this issue. One fine morning, when we check our mails, we get a mail from our you know, same email ID of the customer who was buying from, you know, Germany or anywhere in Europe. Same email ID, the same name, the company logo, everything remains the same. They say, you know, we have changed our bank accounts, and the new account is, you know, as given below. It says Credit Suisse Bank, IFSC code, all this, and UTR, the international, you know, transfer number and all that. So, you know, some people take it for granted that, okay, the customer has sent a mail. It says that he has changed his accounts. So, you know, all consignments, all other, you know, credit-related transactions should happen from this account. I think what we, you know, need to do for this is to call the customer over phone, go back to the age-old, you know, method of calling over phone or writing a letter or sending a fax or whatever, asking them to confirm in writing with a signature saying that the, you know, mail that they have sent is correct and the account has, you know, actually been changed. There have been, you know, companies which have lost money in this also, transferring money to the wrong account, which was not, you know, meant to be done. I think phishing is a major concern. So better to, you know, have something in writing or call them and, you know, confirm this before any, you know, monies are put in or taken out of the newer accounts.
Can I just add to that?
Sure, Samit, go ahead, please.
Okay. So very, very valid thing. And just keep in mind that as technology increases and people use more and more technology, the people who are trying to do this will also get sophisticated. In fact, we have seen organizations in which email comes from the manager to the subordinate or goes from somebody to the manager to the senior most management saying the X and Y has approved and this needs your approval. And it's just so difficult to make out from that email that this is a phishing attack or ransomware. Just a couple of suggestions, especially because you spoke about MSME. And before that, thank you for acknowledging Microsoft. That's what we are supposed to do. First is please use cloud solutions, right? We have gone past the era where people used to think that the cloud is safe. You know, if I keep the data within me in my own data center or my own hardware, it will be safer. You made a very good statement. You're in the business of running your organization. You're not in the business of managing hardware, software, security, etc. Let the people who understand that business manage it. Just like today, many of us, I think, keep most of our jewelry and most of our most valuable assets in a bank locker. We don't keep it with us because they are better designed to manage it. You know, the locker is safe, there's security outside it, there's security outside the entire complex. They are better. We cannot manage that in our homes, right? Otherwise, we all will become small banks. So go the cloud way. Because what happens when you go the cloud way is your software always is updated with the latest version, right? Because whenever somebody is trying to do the attack, they have done a research on a very old software and they're trying to break through that one, which becomes simple because they have mastered that. But if your software is updated, it's very, very difficult to crack through that, right? That's, use the same principle. Why do medicines keep on getting upgraded? Because virus finds a crack to the old medicine and the new medicine then kills the virus. Okay, so please do that. I mean, it is astonishing. If you go around the country and you go around many shops, you will still see so many organizations using Windows XP. That's 10 years old. I mean, I really go and ask those shopkeepers and those small 5 and 6 man shop, that do you use your mobile phone which is 10 years old? And they said, no, every year we change it. And we say, you don't change your software which is running your company, right? So please have the latest software, use it on the cloud. It just helps organizations like us, and I'm not only saying Microsoft, but organizations like us, keep it updated. Because remember, what do we do? We also have research labs where we work faster. And every day, every single day, we have billions of emails all over the world, billions, because Microsoft Exchange and Outlook runs it, right? And we capture a lot of that information to try and understand how to, from where will an attack come in and we quickly seal that, right? That's how research happens. So that will really, really help to keep things updated. Second is that we provide things along with our partners, or just give us a call, give me a call and say, I'm scared. Can you come and do a workshop? And we will use your data and your premises to do a workshop and say, these are the vulnerabilities which there, which exist. And then, you know, we can find ways of keeping them out. So I just thought I'd add that back to you.
Thank you, Mr. Samik. So since we serve a lot of MSME businesses, I would like to add a couple of my perspectives. See, number one is, I'm very happy that you spoke about the threats to that, the cybersecurity threats and other things, because as a technology vendor, when we go and talk to many of the businesses, it's basically like, we advise somebody, why don't you do some physical exercise, eat healthy and all. They say, I'm very young, nothing will happen to me. After they are diagnosed diabetic or they get BP or heart attack, they start, next day you can see them walking after they recover, right? So that is the same attitude that is there for the business. Till the time it happens, people always say, it's not going to happen to me. It has not happened in the last 10 years, so it's not going to happen to me. Maybe because I'm doing more punyam than everybody else, right? So first, that has to change. So, everybody have to recognize that that threat is real. And same thing is, I totally agree with Mr. Samik that, about the, using the latest software, right? But the most important thing is, there are lots of service providers, and especially in place like, India, that the software used by all the businesses, there is very high degree of fragmentation. And in many businesses, software that is developed 10 years back, where the guy who developed is not even there, people continue to use the software because functionally it meets their need, right? So they don't want to change it. But everybody have to ask this question, is the software, ready to face today's, cybersecurity challenges? For example, is the organization that is building the software ISO 27001 certified? Because this ISO 27001 is a security certification. If my software vendor is not ISO 27001 certified, and if they don't even know about it, then you know how much risk you have. It's basically like when you fall sick, you go and see whether somebody has an MD in specialization in something and then meet the doctor. You don't meet anybody who claims to be a doctor. So this ISO 27001 is a security certification. So you can check and make sure, is my vendor certified? And second is, whatever solution I use, there is something called VAPT, vulnerability assessment and penetration testing. So good companies, all the good, even cloud service providers or whatever software service providers, they have the practice of doing the vulnerability assessment and penetration testing every quarter internally and every year with an external agency. Okay, so it is like doing financial audit. Depending on the size of your business, you have monthly internal audit, quarterly external audit, and definitely an yearly audit. So same way, if you are a MSME, you can't afford a VAPT assessment for your own organization, but you are not building software. You are only deploying what you buy and integrating them and deploying them in your organization. You have to make sure every one of your vendor is having the practice of doing this vulnerability assessment and penetration testing, right? So in my view, what many business do is they don't look for these criteria. So whatever is lowest price they buy, but if a vendor have to do these things, then the vendor quality is also higher and you have to pay for the peace of mind they can deliver. So that is very important. So two things, one is ISO 27001, and the second is, do they have this VAPT as a practice in the organization? Both are important.
Yeah, I just want to add one more line to before we take the next question. Creating And maintaining high awareness among employees is very, very important. So do's and don'ts, like simply not clicking on a link which comes from a mail, which from a person you really don't know. Very, very simple things, but are very effective as a preventive. Let's go to the next question.
Hello. Good afternoon, sir. I'm Vasudevan. I just brought a small question to Mr. Vembu, sir. As we are moving to digital world, but there is one challenge that we are facing today is after the COVID, most of us have started working from home. When we started working from home, the bandwidth that we find is very difficult to manage the digital people we are using it. So I think digital infrastructure also should grow simultaneously to people to accept digital in a bigger way. So that area, I feel we are not come to that level, because I find many times the system doesn't work, the connectivity goes off, and when we have to call the service providers to reconnect when multiple people are using at a different point. So my only request is that if you could also touch upon the subject to simultaneously take digital infrastructure also to reach our panoramic view into digitization as we are moving forward. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. I agree with you, but one thing I would say is, you know, for many, even some of these challenges, looking within can is the first step we have to do, in the sense that, you know, like at least 80% of the time, whenever we find such infrastructure bottlenecks, when we look at why do we really need so much infrastructure, right? Are we using the infrastructure in an optimal manner, right? And can we optimize that usage? When we do those kind of things, we are able to work within the given infrastructure 80% of the time. So I agree with you, there will be certain situations, you know, where you will really be constrained by the infrastructure. But you know, today, whatever is available, you know, in terms of the internet and how it performs and things like that, you know, like we are a team of about 350 people, and we, you know, it's almost like 350 offices, you know, and you know, if anything, you know, I can say our productivity has only increased by working from home. You know, people are able to do more, you know, and some people say that they even work with their mobile hotspot to do critical work in servicing customers or in doing development or whatever. So you know, I assume, you know, you are not in a very, very high, you know, graphic designing kind of work which requires a much higher bandwidth. But if it is not so, then we really have to analyze with some good performance management tools to see why do we really much infrastructure. Because whenever we have faced this problem, or any of our customers face this problem, we always ask that question, and 80% of the time we are able to optimize. That's the one thing I would really want you to look at. Thank you.
So just in lighter vein, many people doesn't want to use a lot of bandwidth and come on video, because they say that my connectivity is poor, my bandwidth is poor, so I don't want to come on video, because probably they are not dressed to the protocols that is required. So I think what we see is, in many cases today, at least urban cities, the bandwidths are in acceptable limits to carry out uninterrupted work, including video and collaboration and whatever work that needs to work. There are some pockets of rural, many people have actually, our employees have traveled to their hometowns and villages. And there are pockets of those places where people have found network connectivity is poor. And we have kind of facilitated with them in terms of either they can move to the city and come back to the work location, or they have moved on to more like we have provided data cards or some kind of dongles to use 4G LTE and other facilities. With that, I would say 90%, 95% we could manage the network issues.
Well, yeah, that's a practical thing to do, and thank you for those. Okay, I'll just hand over to you. It's a fact that the coverage definitely needs to be enhanced, and I'm sure the service providers will rise to the challenge. Hari, you want to ask a question?
I think one last question before we close and go. Yeah, please. I meant I had the last question, but I'll go after you.
Okay, so thank you. Thank you for the opportunity given. This is Kundabai, and I represent Center for Entrepreneurship Development based at Madurai. And I'm the center head of an Aishwar Mota's CSR initiative, where we train the diploma candidates. So my question is to Mr. Satyakam Arya. Sir, diploma candidates have been recruited in Daimler under the scheme of NEEM and NAPS. My request and inputs from you would be like the students or my trainees who are recruited under NEEM scheme or NAPS scheme, after a year or three, depending upon the scheme, they come out and they get back to their hometowns. There are about 30% of my candidates who are left, they don't work actually, and they are left on their hometown. This session being lives, livelihood, and growth, I would look out for a sustainability for their employment as an extended, employment, I would say. Be it NEEM scheme or NAP scheme, the idea is to develop them so that they get back to wherever places they are and they become an entrepreneur, or with the apprenticeship badge, they establish themselves. This 30%, I really wanted to, it was a concern which I like to put forth to you. So one suggestion or input which I would give it to you is there a possibility to pick out at least 1% of those NEEM scheme or NAP scheme under an entrepreneur based initiative? It's just a light which I would like to throw on. Thank you once again.
Sure, thank you. Thank you for your question. Well, we have very recently recruited a lot of people under NEEM and NAPS because we are ramping up production in line with market demand, and we'll continue to do so. As I understand, I'm not in too much details of this program, but as I understand, they work for 36 months, and after that, subject to a qualification test, either they are absorbed in our company or they can be employed by other companies, and we will continue to do that. And I will definitely look at your idea of can we encourage some towards entrepreneurship, not one but even more. Thank you.
I just have one question to Mr. Satish. I think your video was very impressive, taking us through the factory and through the manufacturing process. I was just telling Mr. Satyakam while I was viewing the video that we didn't see a single human being, nor did we see a cow, but that apart. Is your factory actually, are you very, very thin on labor, and are you automized to a very large extent?
Actually, recently we came out with a fully automated, fully robotic plant. We initiated this 4 years before, and last 2 years it is completely in the operation. Previous this plant, this is a new plant, is almost 55 acres of land with more than 500 crore investment. Previously, old plant, it's a 1 acre land and with more semi-automated plant. So being in the dairy and niche agri, we want to make a premium, in the sense hygiene plays a big role in dairy, particularly in the dairy products industry. So we gone with the globally the best technology globally, which is the best example. If you take paneer, which is the world's biggest paneer plant we set up. And this technology, as of now, nobody is having in all over the world. We only first gone with this technology, and we worked with one German company for almost 7-8 years. And we made, with great difficulty, we made it. Likewise, each and every process, we gone with the best technology. And moreover, see, all the industry, how much you are giving this job here, we want to eliminate more human intervention in each and every process. Otherwise, it is very difficult to give the quality product. As I said, it is hygiene plays a big role. Particularly, milk is a highly contaminated if something goes wrong. So that is our intention to go with the more automation. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, we have 5 minutes remaining, and I would like to now close the session with the last question. And this would be very short to each of the panel members. We talked a lot about emerging technologies, mainly focusing on digitalization or digital economies. And we all touched various aspects of what needs to be changed or transformed to make that successful. So I would like to ask each of you up to 3 words on what should be done to make it a successful change. And I will start with you, Mr. Raghuram.
I think from the Tamil Nadu growth, which we are talking of the topic, to continue for the next generation, I put 3 pillars, R&D, technology ecosystem, smart manufacturing, and skill development. These 3 are the pillars we would need to further focus.
Sure. Thank you. Let's move on. Mr. Vembu.
To me, the first one is how can businesses collaborate more? Because when I look at successes in the developed economies, the kind of collaboration they have between businesses, right? So collaboration, can actually speed up innovation, can lead to better R&D, everything. So collaboration is one thing, and trust is the second thing. So as I, as we keep working in the market, somehow, I would say in the last, as I grow up, the trust in the ecosystem keeps going down. But if trust, it can increase the velocity of business, it can accelerate. So how can as society, and the government, can make, even companies can make the environment more trustworthy environment, right? Because we are slowly getting into an environment where employees don't trust their companies, citizens don't trust their government. So that's not good for us. If trust increases, it can really accelerate business. And the third and most important thing is there is a balance required between, I would say investment, skill, and effort. I think we are out of balance now because today money rules, right? And more than, or sometimes the skill rules and the effort is never recognized and things like that. So if there is a balance, so in everything, if we can get a balance, right? So I'll put it as collaboration, trust, and balance are the 3 things that can accelerate any economy. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Vembu. Collaboration, trust, and balance, important buzzwords. Mr. Satish Kumar.
Invest into latest technology. What business we do, we need to keep on upgrading ourselves. We should be a role model ourselves, one. And stay focused what we are doing. And dedicated to our business, what we are completely which we are doing the business, we want to dedicate it into our business. Thank you.
Thank you. Stay focused and invest. Your buzzwords. Samik, are you online?
Yes, I am. Can you hear me? So you gave me liberty of 3, I will only take 3. The first is hybrid workplace. Okay, hybrid workplace will come into being, it will stay, so be prepared for it. The second one I would say is don't go back to old habits. If you go back to old habits and old ways of doing things, we have lost the entire learning from this crisis. So unlearn fast and learn quickly for the new era. And the third thing I would say is use technology to the fullest. Aspects like data, AI, machine learning, analytics will change the way the world will start looking at things. It will change the way the world will start looking at things. So keep an eye on that. Those are the three things.
Okay, unlearn and learn. To you, Hari?
I think I'll stick to three words you said, so I have to explain it briefly. I think the sixth sense is exactly three words. I think human beings are endowed with the sixth sense, which other species do not have. And fortunately or unfortunately, I think today technology is also able to think and make decisions based on data or based on analytics, whatever you call it. I think technology is also, getting on to making decisions quicker than human beings, to making critical decisions, I think, quicker. So I think we have to use our sixth sense, much better and more often than it's being used today.
Thank you, Hari. Sixth sense. Let's not forget about it. We are the only ones on the planet who have it, right? Those were your words. Well, you're right. Technology is making a lot of decisions, but what technology will never have is consciousness. And that can be a topic of our future panel discussion. Let's end this one now. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. Thank you to the panelists for your very insightful comments. And I'm sure every one of us carries something which we can implement in our life or business from here. Thank you very much.
I'd request all members to, please join us for lunch, which is being served outside this hall. And at 2:00, we will assemble back for the first State Council meeting of the newly elected State Council. At 2:00 will be the first State Council meeting. So request elected members to, stay back and attend the meeting. And, some of you who are not part of the State Council may please wait and rejoin at 2:45. It's going to be a very short meeting, the first State Council. At 2:45, we will assemble back. And at 3:00, the Honorable Finance Minister will be joining us virtually, along with Mrs. Mallika Srinivasan, Chairman of TAFE. I request all members to take part in the virtual discussion, and we should close the day by 4:00. Thank you.